Welcome to this segment of the Chemistry of Beer course. In this segment, we are going to be discussing how alcohol affects the brain. This is a topic that I imagine will be of interest to everyone. To begin, we're going to first of all discuss some of the behavioral effects that are seen with alcohol consumption. Then we will discuss some of the physiological effects of alcohol, what areas of the brain are affected. Then we'll discuss the interaction of ethanol with the delta subunit of the GABA A receptor, and that's kind of a mouthful, so we'll definitely explore that in more detail. And then we'll finish by tying up some loose ends and giving a summary of what we talked about. To begin, we're going to talk about rising and falling BACs, or blood alcohol concentrations. A rising BAC, or blood alcohol concentration, is associated with increased elation, excitement, and extroversion. Drinking alcohol is also associated with an increase in norepinephrine, the neurotransmitter that is responsible for arousal and impulsivity. But as alcohol consumption slows and the blood alcohol concentration declines, there is an increase in fatigue, relaxation, confusion, and depression. To understand how alcohol affects the brain, we need to consider different regions of the brain. The front part of our brain, the prefrontal cortex, is where decision-making and rational thought primarily occur. It is also important for preventing aggressive behavior. The cerebellum, the bottom rear portion of our brain, controls or coordinates motor activity. The hippocampus is another region of the brain that is affected by alcohol. Specifically, the hippocampus is where new memories are formed. This might explain why some people suffer memory lapses. For example, you've perhaps heard the term blacking out after consuming alcohol. So we've discussed some of the various regions of the brain that are affected, but we haven't answered the question, how? How does alcohol affect these regions? Ethanol was known to affect over 100 receptors, but when these were studied in isolation, the results did not always make sense. The dose response effect with some receptors did not make physiological sense. The response was not seen until ethanol concentration was so high that other more severe responses, such as vomiting, would have already occurred. Also, there was some cross-tolerance that had been observed as well. For example, mice that had developed tolerance to Valium were also noted to have developed tolerance to ethanol. So these results were puzzling, and they didn't help definitively answer the question. To begin to answer our question, we first of all need to think about nerve impulses and neurotransmitters. If we look at the two diagrams, we see with the diagram on the left that it's a blown-up view of the axon of a neuron. In particular, this figure is illustrating the process we call an action potential, which propagates as a wave of depolarization along the length of the axon. Basically, as this wave of depolarization traverses the length of the axon, we see that there's a change in the electrochemical potential of the membrane that surrounds the neuron. And this wave of depolarization moves toward the end of the axon. If we look at the lower right-hand corner of the diagram on the right, we see the terminal portion of the axon. When the wave of depolarization reaches the end of the axon, this triggers the movement of vesicles that contain neurotransmitter molecules. It triggers their movement to the membrane itself, fusion with the membrane, and then release of their cargo neurotransmitters. These neurotransmitter molecules diffuse across the synapse, or sometimes called the synaptic cleft, and they bind to receptors and elicit a response. The particular receptors that we want to focus our attention on are the so-called GABA receptors. GABA stands for gamma-aminobutyric acid. It is the major inhibitory neurotransmitter, and it is derived from the amino acid glutamate. Interestingly, GABA does not pass the blood-brain barrier. Shown in our diagram is the structure of GABA. On the left is a very unlikely protonation state of GABA, and on the right is the more physiological relevant protonation state. Now you might wonder why this molecule is called GABA, gamma-aminobutyric acid. The reason why reflects some historical baggage in biochemistry. On the left-hand side, I've labeled the carbons alpha, beta, or gamma, and this is sort of an older nomenclature. So attached to the gamma carbon, we have an amino group. Because we have four carbons in the molecule, 1, 2, 3, 4, this is called butyric acid, and attached to the gamma carbon is an amino group, so gamma-aminobutyric acid. Another name for GABA, and actually a more proper name, according to the International Union of Pure and Applied Chemistry, is 4-aminobutanoic acid. What you should know about GABA receptors are we have two classes. GABA A receptors are ligand-gated ion channels, and GABA B receptors are G-protein coupled receptors. So we're going to focus our attention on the GABA A receptor. If we look at our diagram, this is meant to represent on the top the fusion of a vesicle containing the neurotransmitter GABA and the release of GABA into the synapse or the synaptic cleft. We see that we need two GABAs to bind to the GABA A receptor. When that happens, that triggers the opening of this receptor such that it allows the passage of chloride ions inside the next neuron. The increase in negative charge inside the next neuron lowers the resting potential. It keeps the neuron from firing. This is called an inhibitory postsynaptic potential. So how does it all tie together? That's what we're going to try to answer. Researchers found a less common type of GABA A receptor that contained a delta subunit. This particular type of GABA A receptor responds to low or physiologically relevant levels of ethanol. That was something that hadn't been found previously. And although this is less common, the delta subunit containing GABA A receptor is found in higher abundance in the prefrontal cortex, the cerebellum, and the hippocampus. These are the same regions that we mentioned earlier. So we're ready to tie together some loose ends and to summarize our discussion. We've seen that different regions of the brain were known to be affected by ethanol, but initial work was unsuccessful in isolating a particular receptor that responded to ethanol at physiologically relevant concentrations. Then we saw that more recent work found a particular type of receptor, a GABA A receptor that contains a delta subunit, and this was shown to respond to ethanol at physiologically relevant concentrations. Although there's considerable controversy in this field, and although to a large extent the smoking gun has been found, for example, the delta subunit containing GABA receptors, much work still remains to sort out the myriad of interactions and effects. Nonetheless, a large number of observations make sense in light of the results obtained from the work on the delta subunit containing GABA A receptors.